Heidi Hill there again, boys and girls. Welcome to yet another edition of Live from the Tape Farm. Today we're going to do something a little bit different, something I haven't done on this channel before, which is an unboxing video. Some of you may be aware of a guitar brand called Harley Benton. I became aware of it a year and a half ago. Started watching some videos on it and started getting very intrigued by what that brand was doing. So I thought I would order one, unbox it, show it to you guys, demo it, do all that stuff. Just right up front, clear, transparent. Nobody's paying me to do this. I bought this guitar with my own money. Taumann, the company in Germany that sells these things, did not contact me, didn't do anything. I bought it, my own money. And we're gonna talk a little bit about that, about what it takes to get one of these guitars from Germany to the US. We're gonna talk a little bit about that. It's not as clear as just, you know, going online to Guitar Center or Sweetwater and ordering a guitar. It's not that simple. There's a lot of, there's some ambiguity in that process. But let's get to the unboxing and we'll deal with all that minutia on the back end. So let's look at the box, shall we? As you might imagine, it comes in a big box. So one of the things I wanted to point out to you guys, when I decided what I wanted to do, what guitar I wanted to focus on, I had a few criteria. One was I wanted to get something that I didn't already have. In other words, I have a collection of six strings, I have some basses, I have some hollow bodies, I have solid bodies, I have Tellys, I have Strats, I have Les Pauls, I have a few different guitars here, of which you can see most of them behind me. What I didn't have is I do have a 12-string acoustic guitar, but I did not have a 12-string electric guitar. So I thought what I would do is if I'm gonna do this, if I'm gonna buy something, I'm gonna buy something I don't already have and something I can get some use out of. So when I went looking for a 12-string Harley Benton guitar, there were a few models out there. They had a 12-string that was like a Sunburst, very traditional. They had a black one. They had a Paisley one, which was kind of interesting. And I was looking at all the different ones, and I noticed that the Sunburst one was $215. The black one was $215. For some reason, the Paisley one, which you would think would cost a little bit more because that's a weird or a much harder produced finish, was cheaper. It was $187. And I was initially going to grab one of those. But then I saw another one that was a bundle. And it had the 12 string along with a case, a strap, a tuner, a cable, a few odds and ends. I was gonna get a gig bag for it anyway, but it was less than buying just the guitar. But the bundle only came in black. So I was like, well, black guitar is cool. I actually only own one black guitar, so figured I'd give that one a shot. For less money than just the guitar by itself, you got a case, a tuner, a strap, a cable, you know, odds and ends. So I thought I'd give that a shot. So let's get to the unboxing. But before we do that, let's talk about the box. So this, again, came from Germany. And it appears to have been opened by the lovely and talented people at the U.S. Customs Service. Because they resealed it. But they also, the bottom of the box is a little destroyed. And they put their little U.S. Customs Service tape over the bottom of the box. Now, the bottom of the box here looks like it got wet. So somewhere along the lines, this thing came in contact with some moisture. And hopefully it didn't get to the guitar. I probably didn't, but we don't know yet. Let's open it up and find out. So again, the box, the staples have been opened, so that's... I don't know if that's true of all things coming from overseas, or if they just take a particular sample, or if they only open the guitars. Who knows? But let's open it and see what we see. All All right. Let me see if that's still... Yeah, mostly showing up in view there. All right. So, inside the box, we have the guitar, which is the RB-612BK. Okay, and you'll see why that says RB here in a few minutes. And then let's look and see what else is in here. So we have the gig bag. Pretty nice Thomann gig bag. Appears to be canvas, not some cheap plastic stuff, which I've seen in the past. It's a standard gig bag. It's pretty nice. It's not the most thickly padded, but heck, it's not bad. It's got the little Thomann tagger on there. Let's see what else we got. We got a cable. So fairly nice cable, Thomann cable. I believe it's a 10-footer, if I'm not mistaken, or probably closer. That comes from Germany, so I'm guessing it's in meters. But yeah, decent cable. So we got 6, 12, 18, about 20 feet, about a 20-foot cable. So that's nice. Let's see what else is in the box here. So we got an old strap. So we got the a nice canvas, nylon canvas strap with, it's pretty nice. I don't know if that's actual leather, probably not. So pleather. So genuine Naga hide. Which I think we need to stop the senseless killings of Nagas just to get their hides. But there we are. So a nice strap came along with it. And their branded guitar tuner. Which I will need, I'm sure, to tune this thing up. So I have other ones. But we'll use this one because it came with the guitar. So now let's open the guitar and see what we got. All right. So the box itself here does not look as though it got wet, but it does have a little hole in the bottom, which tells me that the strap button took a whack and came through the bottom of this box. So let's hope that everything is still intact. Harley Benton, just so everybody knows. All right. In case of fire, rescue my guitars. A little sticker. I will put that on the window of the studio. So in here comes with yet another cable. You know, you're just your standard cheapo cable and your standard Allen wrenches for adjustment. But now let's get down to the brass tacks. So there's where the strap button kind of busted through. So I got my fingers on the headstock and that seems to be in one piece, so that's good. So let's unbox it here. Let's unbag her. See what we got. All right, so right off the bat, before I even get going, we can see we have a chip out of the headstock. So the headstock appears to be in one piece, but we do have a paint chip right out of the, before I even take the bag off. So let's keep going, see what we got here. So there we go. Well, I will tell you, first impressions, right, like just holding it in your hands, it's a looker. It's kind of a stunning piece. Little inspection card. Somebody inspected this before it went out the door. Still has the Harley Benton tagger on it here. So let me give it the good old just once over. Check for any other dings or dents from shipping. And I don't really see any more that jump out at me other than that one there at the top of the headstock. So I may or may not contact them about that, but we'll see. We'll see how it goes. But overall, so we have a pretty nice bound fretboard. Let's look down here, nice and flat. I don't feel any fret ends, which is kind of nice. Knobs move nice and smooth. Switch is operational and switching smoothly. I have noticed that manufacturers have been shipping guitars in tune or close to it. Let's see here. Not so much, but I wouldn't expect it to be. I mean, came all the way from Germany. So we will endeavor to tune this guy up, but let's go over some of the finer details here. So humbucker pickups that appear to be kind of they say they're called mini humbuckers in the catalog or on the listing. What they call a Rick-O-Matic bridge, which is kind of interesting. It's got the little cover over the top of it. So as we know, so just looking at this, we can tell this is let's not call it a copy. Let's not call it that. Let's not call it a clone or anything. Let's say it is inspired by. We'll say it is inspired by Rickenbacker. Now, we all know, or if you do any, so if you know any fine detail about guitars, Rickenbacker is very, very touchy about people copying their guitars. They are they put a stop to it pretty quick. That's why it's nearly impossible. You could get a Strat copy anywhere. You could get a Les Paul copy anywhere. But getting a Rickenbacker inspired guitar is pretty hard. And the fact that I had to go all the way to Germany to get one. Well, I didn't, but you know, I mailed off. So that's kind of an interesting aspect. If you can do a little research on that one, but Rickenbacker is very, very, in fact, if you notice, I'm not allowing the name Rickenbacker to be heard. I had planned all along. Anytime I said Rickenbacker, I was going to put a little beep. Just because I didn't want anybody to come after me. So, but let's look at, again, some fine details here. This is pretty nice. Look at the binding. The binding has kind of a nice age to it. But it also has, see that little fine line there, right? So you got the binding and then this fine white line. It's just a nice touch. It's a very nice touch. So overall, I'd say I was really, really impressed. So let's talk about price of this guy. So when all is said and done, I believe the price, like the list price on there was $205 US. Now it's also listed in euros because again, Germany. But if you go to the US side of the website, it'll show you that it's $205. For everything, the guitar, the case, the cable, the whole shoot and match. Then there's $30 international shipping. Now, the way this works is the exchange rate fluctuates from moment to moment. So if you were to add those two together, you'd say, oh, okay, so it's $235 for the guitar shipped. Yeah, in a perfect world, I'd probably say that's correct. But when it hits, like I purchased it through PayPal, you can do it through a credit card or wherever, but I did it through PayPal. PayPal did it in euros. So it said, you know, it's this many euros. And that price, what finally comes out of my PayPal account or would come out of your credit card account if you purchase using a credit card of some kind, would be from when it ships, whatever the exchange rate is in that moment, that is what the cost of the guitar is. So when this shipped, which was I ordered it, and I think it shipped out a day later, when all was said and done, it cost me roughly $250, which again, not bad for a guitar that looks like this, okay? $250. Here's something else, another little detail. Inside the F-hole is painted, same or bound. Not really painted, it looks like it's bound. Maybe it's paint, hard to tell, but it looks great. So $250. So I ordered it and it shipped out on the 2nd. And today is April 2nd. Today is April 12th. I don't know when exactly I'll post this, but it's April 12th when I got it. So 10 days, I spent a couple of days in US Customs in Miami, who were the people nice enough to open it and make sure it's not something nefarious. So $250 shipped, but I had to go down to the post office to get it because there was still money owed on it. An additional $22.42, I think. So, and I believe some of that is customs, some of that was insufficient postage. So there was a couple of different charges that I was still had to incur. So it isn't just straight up, you know, pay the price and it ships to you. There are some things that some variables. In Europe, there's a thing called VAT, V-A-T, or value added tax. I believe that's what VAT stands for. People who are members or countries who are members of the European Union, the EU, pay this VAT tax, which is a certain percentage of sales. It's like a sales tax, but you will pay the like your local sales tax and a VAT tax on top of that. Part of the customs charges that I paid may have included the VAT. Some of it was VAT tax, I believe. Here's the thing about VAT tax. If I really want to get crazy bad, and I think $6 was six. They broke it out for me at the post office, and I think $6 of it was the VAT. If I wanted to, I could appeal the paying of the VAT tax because I don't live in the EU, so I shouldn't have to pay it. But for $6, that seems like an awful lot of bureaucratic nonsense to go through for $6, doesn't it? And trust me when I tell you, they count on that. They count on the fact that I'm not going to go through that bureaucratic nonsense to get $6 back. So they got my $6. So the EU got my $6. But I got this, so not a bad trade-off. So when all is said and done, we're probably looking at about $274-ish, give or take, total. Not bad. I can't complain about that at all. So let's get this guy tuned up and see what she sounds like. So as I'm tuning this, I am noticing, so everything's about a whole step flat or so, which, you know, that's gonna happen. I'm not worried about that at all. But these tuning pegs, the tuners, they're not exactly the best. I will tell you there's a lot of play. You can turn it for like an eighth of a turn and nothing happens. You can feel the play, like you can turn it back and forth and see that it's, and feel it, not only hear and see, but also feel. That's not really turning anything. So there is a little bit of that involved. So I would say right now, if there was anything that I'm concerned about, it would be the tuning pegs. I mean, after all, we're dealing with 12 strings, which is a lot of string tension. But it's just more things to go out of tune, right? So more strings you have, the more likely it is to go out of tune. So if you have 12 tuning pegs that maybe don't have the best tuning stability, you're gonna possibly end up with 12 strings all slightly going out of tune with each other. But we'll see over time. I mean, I've had tuning pegs that, you know, maybe don't feel the best, but they stay perfectly in tune. I have an Epiphone up there, an Epiphone Les Paul, that, you know, tuning pegs aren't the best, but it has never gone out of tune. Once I get it in tune, put new strings on it, stretch the strings out, do all that good stuff, it doesn't go out of tune. So while the tuning pegs may not feel the best, they're stable. So that's really what I'm concerned with. And once I get it in tune, it will stay in tune, at least for a reasonable amount of time and a reasonable amount of me banging away on it. If you've never had a 12-string guitar before, I've had 12-string acoustic for 35 years. That, for a very long time, was my main instrument. That's pretty much all I played was a 12-string acoustic. And I will tell you that tuning a 12-string guitar is a little bit more of an art than anything else, and getting it to be stable can sometimes be a very interesting thing. But we are now in tune, so let's plug her in and see what happens. All right, so I've set this up in Logic. We're just going to use some amp sims in Logic just so I can sync them easier with the video later. This is basically like a clean Vox setup. So we'll go with the bridge pickup first, and then we'll run it through its paces. Just some quick chords, simple chord pattern. So now let's go with the neck pickup. So I'm about a 12 string, man. And then this is both pickups. An interesting tone variation. Interesting tone variation. It's not it's an obvious difference between the bridge and the neck pickup, but not huge. More meat, obviously, in the neck pickup, as you would expect, but when the two go together, there's a definite difference there. So let's give it a little bit more of a crunch. All right, so this is a little bit of a different amp tone. So this is again more of a kind of a Vox, but a little bit more gain to it. So again, this is a bridge. I'm going to do the same chord pattern for a number of reasons. One, so you can just hear the difference from pattern to pattern, and there's no, hopefully, very little variation. But two, frankly, I don't want to get blocked. And if I play some chord pattern that happens to be in some obscure song, I don't want this thing blocked for whatever reason. So we'll just play that same chord pattern. The bridge pickup. So now the neck pickup. Both pickups. So we'll put a little chorus on here. So for the most part, 12-string guitars, I mean, I know people who play lead on them. I'm not a very good lead player.
At all.
But two, I'm also not Stevie Ray Vaughan, who could play lead on a 12-string, if you've never seen that video, by the way. MTV Unplugged with Stevie Ray Vaughan. Find that one, because it's pretty amazing. But playing lead on 12 string is a bit cumbersome, so. So yeah. So more of a chord thing and background strumming for effect to fill things out. And that's the main reason I got this guy. There's actually one song that I'm working on right now that I was like, ooh man, a 12 string would really go really well right there. So I took my 12-string acoustic down, tried it with that, didn't quite cut it, even put a pickup in it, and set, no. But this guy should definitely do the job. So one other thing, let's look at the controls. So we have the obvious three-way switch. So that's your bridge, neck, both, volume, for your neck, volume for your bridge. Both of those seem to perform really well, very, very smooth. You'll get some that, where you'll hit the note and it will just all of a sudden just die. This doesn't do that. So very, very good taper. They use an audio taper pot on there, which is what you should use. And then as far as the tone goes, again, same thing. Very, very gradual. It doesn't just all of a sudden, boom, dive off a cliff. So good potentiometers in there. As far as their functionality. Now, what there are in there, we're gonna find that out, because we're gonna open this guy up and take a peek and see exactly what's going on in there as far as the electronics go. So let's check that out. All right, so I just took all the screws out and we're gonna open this guy up and see what we got inside. So we are dealing with little dime-sized potentiometers. But hey, you know, they work and, they perform better than most. So this has the traditional, double like other, Bachers do, the double thickness pick guard or scratch guard. So you have the single piece that covers over the control, and then a smaller piece here that is, looks like it's glued. Yeah, there seems to be a little bit of glue right there. That's glued, so this is glued together. So it gives you that little two-tier step up looking thing. In the cavity, let's look here. I will tell you that it looks like, it really does. It does, it feels like it and it looks like it. So I really do think that's shielding paint in there. Now there is no shield foil on the pick guard itself. That would be a nice plus, but again, we have to remember what we're talking about here. We're talking about a $250 guitar, more or less, with government fees about $270. The wiring itself, as far as the quality of the soldering and whatnot, we all know these things are made in China. We know that. But the quality of the soldering is good. I don't see anything jumping out at me that would make me go, yeah, I need to flow solder over that, or man, they used hardly no solder there, or they used a big just glob of solder. Nothing that jumps out at me that tells me something would need to be changed. Dime-sized potentiometers, but hey, you know, they work. They are the right kind of potentiometers, and they definitely do the job. So I'm not too worried about that. I have heard people say, oh, those things don't last. Compared to what, exactly? I mean, I've seen potentiometers in guitars for 50 years. You know, they need a little cleaning every now and then, but you're telling me that, what, these will only last 30 years? Okay, I'll take that. Thanks. But I guess if I wanted to do any sort of quote-unquote upgrade to this guy, that might be one of them, but overall, what I would probably do, though, is take this out and put a little foil, or maybe paint the bottom of that with some shielding paint, or just do something more to do a little bit more shielding. Not that I heard anything that jumped out at me that said, oh, my God, this thing's buzzing like crazy. Plus, we're also dealing with humbuckers to begin with, so it's not that big of a deal. But overall, the route looks good. There is a little bit of sawdust here and there. You know, you see me kind of picking off some of this sawdust that was underneath the pick guard. But you know, that's going to be, I don't care what guitar you get, that you're going to see that. So I'm not too worried about that either. Plus, it's also under the pick guard, right? So yeah. So decent electronics. Are they the best thing in the world? No. But again, this is not a $3,000 bucker. This is a $250 to $270, depending on your VAT tax and whatnot, Harley Benton. So we need to take that into account. So let's get her back together and see what else we can play with. All right, so now let's do just a real fine tooth comb kind of fit and finish kind of look here. Here's one little thing that I saw. So you can see that little blemish right there. And again, I'm pointing this out not to say, oh my God, this is a horrible, horrible thing. It's not why I'm pointing this out. I'm pointing this out to say, this is the difference between a $3,000 guitar and a $250 guitar. If things like that bother you, get the $3,000 guitar. If things like that don't bother you, they don't bother me. And if the sound is good and it plays well and everything, you know, get the guitar that works best for you as far as your price range, your what you need it to do, and the things that you are willing to put up with. Some people, that would just drive them batty. Me, it doesn't really drive me all that batty. So you see that, and you can see, you know, this is my finger. Okay, so I'm zoomed in pretty darn close here, and that's what we're talking about. Let's look inside this F-hole here. I've heard some people complain about like a lot of glue and paint and whatnot inside the cavity.
There is definitely some stuff in there. You can see that stuff. Not sure if that's anything that can come out of there or not. But if not, again, that's some of the differences. So this is also semi-hollow body, so I can feel the block in here. So it's not a full hollow body, which would be normal. But yeah, that's the type of thing that that I see from a fit and finish. You know, that little thing in the F hole. All the rest of the lines, honestly, appear to be pretty darn good. Let me see here. What's that there? No, that's just a little speck of dust. You know, the chrome plating, maybe not, you know, the best in the world. You can definitely see some waviness there. You see that? So, you know, you're not going to see that on a higher end model. You're not going to see that kind of waviness in the chrome. It literally is going to look like a mirror. So that's the type of differences we're talking about. When people wonder, well, what the heck's the difference between a, you know, a $3,000 guitar and a $300 guitar? It's that. I mean, there's some other things, obviously. I mean, the selection is of wood, you know, tonality to some extent, you know, but honestly, I've heard guitars that cost $5,000 that sound like crap, and I've heard guitars that cost $300 that sound fantastic. So, you know, cost is not the only variant. Cost is not the only thing that determines whether an instrument sounds good or not. So let's take a good close look at these frets and the fretboard. Now this, obviously, it has a rosewood look to it, but it's not rosewood. I think they call it acior or something along those lines, which I will find out for sure and put a little blurb in here and let you know exactly what that is. But it is obviously a not a rosewood fretboard for obvious reasons. Nut appears to be cut well. Tuning, one of the things I checked earlier, I didn't put it on camera, was, you know, you open tune and then you fret the first position and see if that is still in tune. On nuts that are not cut correctly, you will see that to be, you know, if it's not cut correctly, you will press and fret that string and it'll be sharp because, you know, it's cut too high and you're having to press down too far and you're making the note go out of tune. Not the case here. That appears to be just fine. And again, the only other thing that I found was that little chip there out of the headstock. Let's flip her over and see what we see on the back. All right, so yeah, just your black backing. Let's take a close look at the heel, the neck joint. And as we can see, you know, nothing that jumps right out at me and says, hey, this is a problem, or it's a good solid looking joint. Then we have our tuning pegs. Again, that's probably something that I would change out if I were gonna change anything on this straight away. That would be it. I've still got the little plasticky things on there. Well, make sure they don't get scratched. So it looks like some of them have already fallen off. But so yeah, so those need to come off. But I mean, it's solid. Nice binding. And all the binding has, you know, has a little bit of a yellow, like almost vintage quality to it, which is kind of nice. lastly, a nice close-up of these pickups, which again, they have kind of a, you know, they're listed as mini humbuckers. That's the way they're listed on the website. So I don't think they're filtertrons or anything like that. I think they are actually what they call them. Nice. These are, you know, actual metal surrounds, not some cheap plastic that's chrome plated. Actual metal, which is nice. Again, plating wise, you know, probably not the best in the world, but certainly not the worst in the world either. I've seen a lot worse. In fact, I would say the plating on the trapeze is the worst plating on the guitar. So that's it. So you see a little bit of wave there. Not so much in the cover over the Rick-O-Matic bridge, as they call it. And these actually look pretty good as well. So again, $250, guys. Can't really complain. Except for that.
The Harley Benton RB-612BK, BK being for black. Overall, I would say I am very pleased. I definitely think the guitar is well worth the money, the time it takes to get. Just overall, the stuff that you have to do outside of ordering from a US-based store. So I think it's well worth the time and some of the ambiguity. I didn't realize I was gonna be paying that extra $22 and change when I picked it up from the post office. And I have heard accounts where that's not always the case. So I guess it just depends. So you may or may not end up with a little bit more of a bill when the guitar arrives. So other than that nick right there, very pleased. I am really astonished, actually, at the fretwork. It's really good. The action is I think as good as you could ask for at a guitar of this price range, and the fact that it's 12 strings, that's a lot of neck pressure. I may see what I can do with it. I may lower it a tiny bit, but it's not bad. I mean, let me see if I can't get this in here so you can see. So it's not bad. So it's probably as low as it's gonna get. I tuned it once this entire time and it stayed in tune. So while I'm not a total fan of these tuning pegs, the tuning machines, they do have a little bit of play to them. Once you turn it past that play, they tune up, and so far they've stayed in tune. So hopefully that will be the case going forward. Electronics, no complaints whatsoever. Dime-sized pots, but they're smooth as heck, and they do their job exactly the way they're supposed to do it. So good three-way switch. It's not loose at all. I felt a lot of these that are kind of wobbly and loose feeling and cheap feeling. This doesn't feel cheap. It feels like I could whack on it, and it would take a licking. Now, over time, that may not be the case, but right now, right out of the box, pretty happy. Detail work, pretty astonished, actually. One other little thing that I didn't notice earlier that I noticed as I was putting things back, unplugging stuff. Little bit of a gap there. Tiny, tiny little bit of a gap between the plate and the guitar. But honestly, that's it. So other than the little things that I mentioned earlier, fit and finish wise, good, solid, solid guitar. So I would not hesitate to purchase another one. I may down the road, but for right now, I wanted to get something that I didn't already have, something else in what I call my arsenal of freedom, is what I call my guitar collection here. Every 4th of July here in the States, I post a little thing about a particular guitar I have. I'm gonna take it down. So this is a guitar I picked up at my local guitar center. It is just a Epiphone with a Epiphone Wilshire body. Now I have under here, this is a clear plastic thing. When I picked this guitar up, I picked it up dirt cheap because it was, it had a company underneath that clear plastic, a local Nashville company, State Water Heaters. So apparently they must have given away a guitar to somebody and they had no use for it or whatever. So they gave the guitar or sold the guitar to a guitar center, got whatever they could out of it, and I picked it up. So when I picked this up, it had State Water Heaters on it. And I thought, you know what, if I could get that stuff off that plastic, I could do something with this. So I toyed with a couple of different ideas, but ultimately what I put underneath there was a copy of the United States Constitution. So what I always say every 4th of July about my guitar collection, like I said, that I call the Arsenal of Freedom, not one of these is a high dollar guitar. They've all got their little dings and dents and their imperfections, every single one of them. But when used properly, when used together, they can make some pretty incredible music. And that's the same with us. We're not perfect. We're not all the same. And thank God for that. We all have our imperfections. We all have our niches, the things we're good at. And we have some things that we're not so good at. But if we work together, there's some amazing stuff we can accomplish. So that's all I got for you today. Catch you guys later.
Hey folks, thanks for watching. The Tape Farm specializes in analog to digital transfers of many prosumer tape formats. From standard cassettes up to 16-channel multi-track recordings, we specialize in formats from manufacturers like Tascam, Fostex, Alesis, and others. So if you have some old tapes in your closet that you'd like to get converted to digital files that can be loaded into your DAW of choice to either relive or remix the past, send them on to us. You can check us out at thetapefarm.com.